Hello, dear colleagues. I am Galin Gavrilov, an orthodontist from Sofia, Bulgaria. In these unprecedented times for our profession, I ended up with some free time to share with you my 15 years of experience in orthodontics. I've decided to start a video series about orthodontic treatments, explaining how a well-taught treatment plan and its execution lead to good and stable results. I'm trying to popularize among dentists the idea that no matter what orthodontic background they have, one should dedicate time and effort to each case, for the sake of the patients, and also in order to not violate the principle primum non nocere from Latin, as you know, must not harm. I hope you'll appreciate it and share it with your colleagues. Please enjoy these videos, which I start with class 3 treatment options. Here is a patient who is 19 years old. He's presented with a skeletal class 3 and facial asymmetry because of an asymmetric and overdeveloped mandible. The patient has been treated at the age of 14 with braces, unfortunately before the end of the growth spurt. We do not have clinical records of his previous orthodontic treatment. However, after the continuous growth of the mandible, he now has a severe class 3 molar relationship, upper right lateral incisor and canin in crossbite position, and also the left molars in crossbite occlusal relationship. The malocclusion is aggravated by edge-to-edge bite of the incisors and asymmetric mandible with shifting to the right. This traumatic occlusion of the incisors left untreated poses risks of gingival recessions later on in the patient's life. This accentuated in its severity class 3 malocclusion shows in cephalometric tracing A&B angle of negative 4 degrees and width appraisal of minus 12 millimeters, hypodivergent growth pattern, compensatory maxillary incisor proclination, and mandibular incisor retroinclination. This is clearly a surgical case. On the OPG, one can see a missing lower left second premolar and persisting second primary molar. In such cases, it becomes obvious that the final orthodontic treatment of skeletal class 3 should be done after the growth has ceased, to avoid situations where we end our treatment and the remaining growth leads toward unwanted changes in the occlusion. Such facial skeletal asymmetry in adults can be corrected only by means of orthognathic surgery, more on the topic in the videos to come. This patient refused such kind of treatment, which led me to think for orthodontic camouflage and extraction of the retained deciduous lower left second molar. The biomechanics revolve around keeping the lower left molars in place and to avoid anchorage loss, so I had to use a bone anchorage, a miniscrew between the lower first and second permanent molars. We started his treatment in December 2015 with segmented arch wire approach by leveling and aligning the lower left buccal segment. In January next year, started the distal movement of lower left canin and first premolar towards class 2 relationship by using sliding mechanics over a 17 by 25 stainless steel arch wire by means of direct bone anchorage in a closing NITI coil spring attached to the head of the miniscrew. This arch wire dimensions in 22 bracket slot has the necessary rigidity and friction for controlled root movement. After 2 months and 2 millimeters of tooth movement in March, a reactivation of the coil spring must be done. After 2 more millimeters of tooth movement in May, another reactivation could be necessary. In June, 6 months since the beginning of the treatment, we have accomplished a class 1 canin relationship on the left side, but overcorrection is needed and class 2 canin relationship is our goal. We aim to move the lower middle line to the left in order to achieve normal overbite and overjet as a camouflage of the asymmetric mandible. For the next 3 months, in September, around 9 millimeters of distal canine movement has been produced. On the left side, class 2 canine relationship has been established without any anchorage loss, and the molars are in their starting position. This is the moment when all brackets are bonded and 16 thermoactive NITI arch wires are placed in both dental arches. At the same time, 3/16 crisscross elastics have been introduced for correction of the canine crossbite to the right, along with temporary buildups on maxillary molars for bite disarticulation. For only 2 weeks, a crossbite has been resolved, but the elastic wear continues because it helps shifting mandible incisors to the left. In 2 months' time, in November 2016, things started to look much better. The alignment, midline coincidence, and minimal overbite have been achieved. The arch wires were changed to 16x22 thermoactive NITI wires. In a month, an obvious mistake was observed. Distal tipping of lower left canine because of the force from the spring which had bent the leveling arch wire. This is the reason why sliding mechanics should be avoided while using non-steel arch wires. Changing the arch wire to 16x22 stainless steel became a must, and a passive lace back on the canine to allow root movement in distal direction. Class 3 box elastics have been placed for better occlusal settling and a power chin for further space closure. Until April 2017, a 17x25 stainless steel arch wire has been in place for nearly 2 months. This is the moment for final evaluation of the achieved goals during the treatment and necessary corrections in any of my treatments. We require an OPG, photos, and dental casts. It appears that wire bends are required to upright maxillary right lateral incisor and mandibular left premolar. I had to remove the miniscrew in this final stage as it has served its purpose. After 3 months, the braces are debonded with a total treatment duration of 1.5 years. The overall achievement was class 1 canine premolar relationship on the right side and class 2 canine premolar relationship on the left side. Thus, I have been able to attain overcorrection on the lower midline to prepare for possible relapse thereafter. A normal overjet and overbite have been achieved as well. Now only the left central incisal edge can be trimmed a little, something the patient wasn't interested in. Usually I put fixed maxillary and mandibular retainers made of 0.25 coaxial multi-strand wire and vacuum-formed retainers as a second level of retention, which is very important in extraction treatment cases, reducing the risk of reopening the extraction space. During the final evaluation of the patient, it was quantified no change in the facial profile and little change in symmetry as expected. We should note this once again, there are limits to all orthodontic camouflage of skeletal problems. On the other hand, the teeth look nice and definitely much better compared to the pre-treatment stage. In August 2018, more than a year after the treatment completion, records were taken routinely for re-evaluation of the retention periods as in all my cases. There were no extra oral changes. Intraorally, settling of the occlusion is particularly good and the results are stable. The midlines, overjet, overbite, and canine relationship are the same as at the end of the treatment. In the time-lapse video, we can take a brief look of the overall change that occurs in the mandible. So, in the end, your take-home message should be: never finalize an orthodontic treatment before the growth has ceased. Thank you for your attention.